Alright, the purpose of this short video is just to go over some of the basic things that we talked about during the course of this unit. Your test is going to be on November 2nd if you're in the blue class or green class, and on November 3rd if you're in the yellow class or the red class. Please review all of the notes, all of the readings. Pay special attention to the maps too, because I have to label a map on this test. And everything should be in your OneNote notebook. You can also look at the four-door book that we made, review book that we made in class as well. Alright, we started the unit by talking about how during the Middle Ages people traveled very little. Learning was not something that was valued, but that started to change as a result of the Crusades, when European leaders sent soldiers into the Holy Land, into the Middle East, to try to recapture Jerusalem from Turkish Muslims that had closed down the Holy Land and prevented Christians from Europe from traveling there and worshiping. As a result of the Crusades, they were not successful, by the way, after fighting for nearly 200 years, but as a result of the Crusades, Europeans came into contact with all kinds of desirable products, spices, silks, jewels, things like ginger, pepper, you know, those kinds of spices were especially valuable, we said, brought them back to Europe, and that increased a desire on the behalf of Europeans to travel and to trade with other parts of the world. At about the same time, an Italian merchant named Marco Polo had traveled to China, spent about 20 years there, and when he came back, published a book about his adventures in China and described what it was like, and again, it helped to increase and spark interest in the outside world for Europeans. Now, Europeans started to trade overland, using overland routes to get to the Middle East and to get to Asia. Those routes were long, and they were slow, and they were expensive, and they were dangerous. As a result, European leaders decided to try to find faster and safer sea routes to get to Asia. Europeans knew the world was round, so sailing off the edge of the planet, we said, wasn't really something that anyone was worried about, but their lack of knowledge of the world, the geographic knowledge of the world, made sailing very dangerous. Up to this point, Europeans, when they sailed, typically sailed along the coast, and you know, followed the coast, within sight of land. But several tools borrowed from Arab and Asian sailors made sailing away from land and out into the sea much more possible. One of those inventions was the magnetic compass, used for finding direction. Another, the astrolabe, used for measuring the position of the North Star above the equator and thus finding latitude, so that's your distance north or south of a location. The caravel was a sturdy ship that was well suited to travel out into rough seas as well. When Gutenberg invented the printing press, that made it so much easier to mass produce books and maps, and again, it was something that allowed Europeans to spread their knowledge, their growing knowledge of the world, and to sail farther and farther and farther away from land, looking for those sea routes to Asia. We took a look at some of the more famous explorers, like Columbus sailing west, and Da Gama sailing east around Africa, and Magellan sailing all the way around the world by going west around South America. So let's come back to Columbus for a second. 1492, Columbus convinces the King and Queen of Spain to give him three ships, supplies, and a crew. In search of a route to Asia, a sea route to Asia, he sails west. He doesn't discover Asia. He maintains that he has until his dying day in 1506, but most Europeans agree that he's found something new. So sailing west to reach Asia quickly seems not to be possible. In 1498, Vasco da Gama, sailing for Portugal, goes in the opposite direction. He sails east around the southern tip of Africa and does reach Asia. He proves it's very possible. It's something that Europeans are interested in doing. It's still profitable, but it's not that quick route that they were hoping for. In 1519, Ferdinand Magellan, sailing for Spain, Portuguese sailor, but sailing for Spain, duplicates Columbus's voyage by sailing west, but he has more knowledge than Columbus had. Europeans know now about the east coast of North America and South America, and so he decides to sail west around the world by going around the southern tip of South America. Without that knowledge of how wide these continents are, the hope is that Asia will be somewhere perhaps right around here, and that quick sea route to Asia will be possible, but it's not. Magellan's crew, after sailing into the Pacific Ocean for an incredibly long time, running out of food, proves that when they finally do arrive back in Spain, that the world is huge. You know, the circumnavigating, sailing around the world, proves that it's round, but that was something that we said that Europeans generally agreed on anyway. Magellan's voyage proves that the world is huge, and if you're looking to get to Asia by sailing west, it's just not at all practical or possible. In fact, it is quite downright dangerous. So this sparks new interest in exploring and maybe exploiting, taking advantage of resources in North America and South America. We talked about the Columbian Exchange. All of those things that Europeans were able to get from the New World or from North America and South America, things like tobacco, the potato, corn, and all of these other things. These were things that did not exist in Europe, Asia, or Africa. They were brand new. Things from Europe that did not exist in North America or South America, like grapes, bananas, sugarcane, different kinds of grains, animals like cattle, sheep, pigs, and horses, and then diseases like smallpox, influenza, and measles especially, were things that didn't exist in North America and South America that Europeans brought with them. So we call this, oh, guns too. I don't have my picture there, but guns were also brought by Europeans to North America and South America. We talked about some of the positive aspects of the Columbian Exchange, like corn and the potato especially, brought from the New World to Europe, helped European populations grow strong. Things like diseases and sometimes guns that were used to kill Native Americans were obviously a negative. Sugarcane helped European countries make a large profit, but had a negative side effect, or impact, I should say, on Native Americans because they were enslaved to work on those sugarcane plantations. And when so many Native Americans died from disease and from overwork, Europeans turned to Africa as a source of slave labor. So that's another negative. The Spanish sent conquistadors, or soldiers. They were interested in gold and glory, and they destroyed Native American civilizations. We talked about how Hernando Cortez, using guns, armor, horses, and unintentionally spreading diseases like smallpox, was able to conquer an Aztec empire of over 1 million people. We also talked about how the Spanish conquistador Francisco Pizarro was able to destroy the mighty Aztec empire after killing their leader Atahualpa in 1535, just a few years after Cortez destroyed the Aztecs. So the Spanish were able to take huge, huge, huge amounts of gold and silver from the New World and bring it back to Spain. This made Spain an incredibly powerful country. The Spanish also set up sugarcane plantations in the New World and their islands in the West Indies, and they also made a tremendous amount of money from their sugarcane plantations. Spanish priests tried to convert Native Americans to Christianity and sometimes were successful, sometimes not successful. The main result of the Spanish occupation of the New World was that Spain became, for a time, the most powerful country in Europe. When the gold and the silver ran out, Spain's power began to decline. As a result of the Spanish conquest, millions of Native Americans died from disease, from being enslaved, and from outright conquest. Now, European countries became jealous of the power that Spain was building as a result of their possessions in the New World and all the gold and silver that they were getting from the New World. So European nations also became interested in finding land in the New World. In the early 1600s, the French, while searching for what we called a Northwest Passage, that is maybe a waterway through or around North America, sent Samuel de Champlain, who explored the St. Lawrence River and the Great Lakes, and that gave France claim to land in North America around the St. Lawrence River and around the Great Lakes, including where we live today. So this French territory in the northern part of North America and around the St. Lawrence River and the Great Lakes was called New France. Towards the end of the 1600s, Robert de La Salle also explored the Great Lakes in New France, but then also sailed down the Mississippi River and gave France claim to all of that land in the interior part of North America, which was called Louisiana. So the Spanish had control of territory they called New Spain, which was what is today the southern part of the United States and Central America, and then Peru in South America. That's the Spanish. The French had New France and Louisiana. We said that the French didn't come for gold and silver. The French actually came for beaver furs, and the fur trade was as profitable as finding and taking gold and silver. The French had a slightly different approach to treating Native Americans, actually a very different approach to treating Native Americans. The French actually learned from Native Americans. They learned how to trap beaver. They traded with them for furs. They lived in their villages, intermarried Native American women. Sometimes they lived with them dressed like them, borrowed their technology. In the painting on the right, you see a fur trapper and a couple of fur trappers, actually French fur trappers, in a canoe, which was a boat used by Native Americans, built by Native Americans. So the French generally had a good relationship with Native Americans. When the Dutch from the Netherlands first came and claimed land along the Hudson River and around Manhattan, the island of Manhattan, they also were interested in the fur trade, and they also had a pretty good relationship with Native Americans in their area. But when the Dutch started to switch over to farming along the fertile Hudson Valley, then they started to run into problems with the Native Americans who lived in those areas. So the Dutch had kind of an up and down relationship. The Dutch colony was very successful. The Dutch settled again on the island of Manhattan. They called their city on Manhattan New Amsterdam, and the entire New Netherland colony extended along the Hudson River. The colony was so successful that the English were jealous of their success. The English, we'll see, had territory north of the Dutch colony and south of the Dutch colony, and in 1664, English warships sailed into New Amsterdam Harbor and threatened to take over the colony, or threatened to destroy the colony if the colony didn't surrender. And the people in New Amsterdam said, "That's fine, you can have the colony as long as we can stay and keep our businesses and keep our homes." And the English said, "Yes. The only change is we're going to start speaking English. That's about it. You can stay and you can continue to be successful." So that brings us to the English. The English also had settlements in North America. The first attempt was at Roanoke Island off the coast of present-day North Carolina. We talked about how this was the lost colony. We don't know really what happened to the settlers who attempted to build a colony on Roanoke. They tried once in 1585 and abandoned that colony, went back to England. In 1587, they tried a second time when their leader, Governor John White, left to go resupply the colony. He headed back to England. We said he was unable to because England and Spain were at war with one another, and it took a few years for him to get a ship and make his way back to Roanoke Island, and when he returned, there was nobody left. And he was unable to search for them because the ship that he came back on headed back to England. They didn't want to stick around. Just a few years later, the English have a second attempt at a colony just a little bit to the north off the present-day coast of Virginia at Jamestown, and that was in 1607. It's the first successful English colony in North America. They settled along the banks of the James River. We'll talk more about Jamestown and Plymouth in the next part of the unit where we really focus on the 13 English colonies. The Jamestown settlers came for gold and for jewels. They thought that they would literally be able to land on the coast and just find these things in the woods. So the first colonists who came to Jamestown were really goldsmiths and jewelers. They weren't people who had experience with wilderness survival skills, and so the colony struggled at first. They were fortunate that a young Native American woman named Pocahontas was helpful to them, and without her help, the colony probably wouldn't have survived. We'll talk more about Pocahontas and what she was really like. It's very different from the Disney version. Just a few years later, to the north, off the coast of present-day Massachusetts and Cape Cod, the Pilgrims set up the second successful English colony in North America at Plymouth. They also struggled at first. They were coming for a very different reason. The Pilgrims were coming for religious freedom. We'll talk more about that. And the precedent that they set for the colonies becoming, the English colonies becoming, a place for haven, a safe place for people from all walks of life and all beliefs and backgrounds. They also received help from a young Native American man named Squanto. And again, he had a very interesting story. He spoke fluent English when the Pilgrims landed on Plymouth because he had so much contact with Europeans. Fishermen, English fishermen off the coast of Cape Cod regularly visited. We said that he was kidnapped once, brought to England, learned to speak English fluently, kidnapped a second time, taken to Spain and enslaved there, and made his way, escaped from slavery, and was able to make his way through Europe all the way back to England, and eventually came back on a fishing boat and was fortunate enough to be adopted into another tribe after his tribe had been wiped out by disease, and met up with the pilgrims and was able to help them. All right, so again, you're going to need to go back through your notes. This is just a very brief overview. Go back through your notes. It's going to be a multiple choice test with a couple of short response questions. So you're going to want to make sure that you can compare what the Spanish, the French, and the English, and the Dutch were doing in North America, you know, what they wanted, what their goals were, where they settled, their relationship with Native Americans, some of the people who either claimed land on behalf of those countries, or some groups like the Coureurs de Bois, those French runners of the woods, the trappers, who were so important to making wealth or generating wealth for France, the pilgrims perhaps for the English colony at Plymouth. And you're also going to want to be able to describe the Columbian Exchange. Okay, so you're going to want to make sure that you know some of the things that were brought from the New World to the Old World, things like the potato, corn, maybe tobacco, and then things that came from the Old World and were brought to the New World. So things that came from Europe that were brought to North America, like diseases like smallpox, horses, guns, sugarcane. You can also maybe talk about that concept of slavery and slave labor from Africa and how Africans were captured and forced to work on plantations. We're going to talk more about that in the next part of this unit. All right, if you have any questions, send me an email. If there's anything on the review sheet that you don't remember or have questions about, or anything about the Columbian Exchange you have questions about, if you want to run something by me, go ahead and send me an email. And again, the tests are on November 2nd and the 3rd.